Welcome back. Off the Record starts right now.
This is a special edition of OTR with the four legislative leaders. From the Democrats, Senate Minority Leader Gretchen Whitmer and House Minority Leader Rich Hammel. From the Republicans, House Speaker Jase Bolger and Senate Majority Leader Randy Richardville. Here's the rundown. An update on the state budget. Are the Republicans really anti-labor? Right to work, will it happen? And is there bipartisanship in the legislature? All this and more coming up right now. Off the Record.
Getting the inside out. It's Off the Record with senior Capitol correspondent Tim Skubick and his Capitol Press Corps colleagues.
Production of Off the Record is made possible in part by a grant from Truscott Rossman, Michigan's only bipartisan strategic communications firm, serving statewide, national, and international clients from their offices in Lansing, Detroit, and Grand Rapids. TruscottRossman.com. By the Michigan Food and Beverage Association, in conjunction with the Michigan Business and Professional Association, working together for its members. Membership information on the web at mishbusiness.org. And by Hager Fox Heating and Air Conditioning Company, providing comfort to mid-Michigan homes and businesses since 1941. Hager Fox and Bryant, for whatever it takes, on the web at hagerfox.com.
And now this edition of Off the Record with Tim Skubick.
Thanks, Joe Donovan, and welcome to this special edition of Off the Record. Our thanks to the legislative leaders for agreeing to appear here. And before we begin, a housekeeping chore. The Speaker's office notified us last week that his attorney has told him that he cannot talk about the IE lawsuit. Is that correct, sir?
That's correct.
And we notified Mr. Hammel of that, and he agreed to leave that off the table for our discussion. So with that out of the way, let's begin.
Did your attorney say anything to you?
No, I have no such direction.
I've lost control already. We're not even into the first question. All right. You guys have said over this past year that these guys are anti-labor. Do you really believe that, Ms. Whitmer?
Well, I think that we have seen a lot of anti-worker legislation move through this legislature, whether it's the emergency financial manager legislation, the recent rush to beat the state commission with regard to the graduate students, having the right to collectively bargain. And so, yeah, I think that, you know, I mean, the governor's not as blatant as Governor Walker is, but a lot of the things that he's signed into law are much of the same ilk.
You agree with that? Yeah. Is he almost like Scott Walker except for the tone?
I'd say maybe the tone might be a little bit different. It's not as abrasive up front, but the legislation that has gone through over the last little bit has been pretty dramatic changes for labor, and the one that's when you can't even collect union dues. And an amendment was offered that said, look, you know, we'll have the teachers pay for that so that there isn't any cost that's affected by that. And the amendment goes down and we still pass the bill. That tells me it doesn't have a thing to do with trying to be fiscally responsible. It's got everything to do about whether labor has simple rights and that they have, that they deserve.
Guilty?
So. Absolutely not. We're pro-taxpayer. As you look at the changes that we've made, they're about government efficiency and making government more efficient. As I talk to private sector unions, people who build things, they go out and work and they say, you're not asking anything that we haven't already given. You're not asking to change anything that we haven't already done. So it's about the taxpayer. It's about making government more efficient. It's about making sure that we have, using the resources we have, that we can provide key and essential services. That's what it's about. It's not about being anti anyone.
At the end of the day, do labor people in this state have less this year than they had a year ago?
When you say they have less, I'm not sure what you mean. Oh, no. I think what we did, in fact, and I'll probably get some disagreement about this, is the legislation that we passed was pro-worker. It may have been anti-union leader, but it was certainly pro-worker. What we're saying is that when money is collected from a paycheck and it's supposed to go toward collective bargaining, and you're using it for political purposes, and a lot of times it's not the political will of the people that the money is being collected from. What we did was we stood up for workers and said, certainly, you have the right to collectively bargain, and money can be collected to do that. But it's not going to be used for political purposes. So I think what we did is we defended the paychecks of the workers. Maybe not the union leaders. They might not like it because they get pretty good salaries right now. But we're looking out for the workers.
I don't think that, I mean, you know, there's a difference between PAC contributions and union dues. Union dues are collected for administration of the union and collective bargaining. There's a difference. There's a clear difference between the two. And when you say that you can't collect union dues, which hamstrings unions from doing the operations that they interact with in the local schools.
We never said
that,
though, Rick.
But that's what that is. There's a difference between PAC
communities. We never said they couldn't collect. We just said that that taxpayer dollars weren't going to be used to make those collections. Certainly you have the
right
to
collect them. And we offered an alternative and you didn't want it.
I heard from many teachers who said that they weren't happy with how their union bosses were behaving themselves and using their union time, what they were paying for. They recognized they were paying for that out of their dues. They said, I don't have the opportunity to hold them accountable. And so by doing this, they have that opportunity. As that worker writes that check or sets up that direct deduction, they have that opportunity to ask, what are my dues going for and how are you serving me? I would agree that it's pro-employee.
Yeah, the transparency piece of it, too. Where are you collecting the money for? And then what is it being used, what's it being spent on? And we want the reporting of those activities, which I think is already federally required anyways. But I think that the workers need to know when money is being collected that they have earned, where's the money being spent? That's all.
Well, I wish you'd take that transparency piece and apply it to your budget. I'm sure we'll get to a budget at some point during this conversation, but you're asking labor to be transparent on something like this, but yet we're talking about budgets that are rolled up. There's no transparency within them. So I think it's got to be fair across the board.
Well, the House does the roll-up. The Senate doesn't.
And with the roll-up, as you know, all the budgets are crafted exactly the way they always have been, and then they're put together, not rolled up. It becomes one budget that has all the same information. There is no less information. There is no less transparency. It is exactly the same transparency.
Are you buying the pro-worker comment from Mr. Richard?
No. First of all, workers are taxpayers. So when you say it's pro-taxpayer to take away workers' rights to collectively bargain, that just falls flat.
No,
that's
rights to collectively bargain were taken away.
Collective bargaining was protected with this legislation. You put the hammer on people's ability. And yes, you took away grad students' right to collectively bargain.
That's not true at all.
It was before the Michigan Employment Commission.
No,
and you stepped in
and
got
to it. It's a misunderstanding, and I can explain it to you.
Before the commission was
going to
make a decision. Because you saw the way that it was going, so you changed the rules right before a decision was handed down.
Not
the rules have been the same for 30 years.
30 years, that's right. And we have signatures from 800 people.
So let the system work.
These are students and teachers.
Judgment.
You finish, then I'll talk, and then when I talk, you can stop.
That'd be nice, and I had started, so I appreciate that. But every time you don't like the way that something's working out, you change the rules. Whether it's Oakland County redistricting, whether it's the grad student unions, you come in, whether it's your own primary, for Pete's sake, change the rules after the votes had been cast so that Santorum would have less than Romney. I mean, what we have seen from this legislature is when they don't like the way that the law is playing out, they go in and change the rules so that they can win.
That's just crazy. I mean, I don't even know how to respond to that at first. We talk about the graduate students first. We got signatures from some 800 professors and graduate students saying, please don't do this. About a year or so ago, the president of the University of Michigan said one of the most important things in educating graduate students is the relationship between the professor and the students. Whatever you do, don't add a third party to that. And we responded to those 800 signatures from these people.
You had a duly elected board of the university, however, that said, we don't want to go there.
They allow the
grad students to union. The elected board of regents said, let's do this.
Well, not exactly. Not all of them. It wasn't
unanimous. Well, it was a majority vote.
And about 30 years ago when that board also unanimously voted Democrat and Republican to uphold the law as it has been for the last 30 years.
Well, aren't you allowed to change something?
Yes, and as the legislature, if you read the Constitution says we have to intervene when there are differences, when there are these kinds of conflicts. We saw a conflict between a decision 30 years ago and the one that was going to happen potentially this time. And so what we did was we sat in and handled the conflict in a proactive way before that board created the conflict. We would have had to resolve that sooner or later anyways. We just did it before it happened.
Again, the key is this has been the same for 30 years. All we're doing is keeping things the same as they've been for 30 years, and I think it is important to look at the underlying issue. What's being fought about is the other side would like to unionize college students. Unionize college students as they do their research work for their graduate degree. What's next? Unionizing fourth graders so they don't have to sweat in PE class? I mean, let's talk about workers. Let's talk about making government more efficient. But that's nothing but a power grab for union dues.
The question was very seriously, what is number one? Are you a student first and an employee second, or are you an employee first and a student second? I don't know anybody that said, I want to go get my PhD as a job. They go to get educated. And what we did is we protected the educational process.
All right, I assume that we're going to agree to disagree on this. How are we doing on bipartisanship, Mr. Hammel?
It's not been very positive. in that vein. There's been very little that's been bipartisan. We've been able to work on a couple of issues. I mean, most recently, the autism legislation that we spoke in advance of the vote to talk about how we would handle that. That was good. Road commission bill was okay. Maybe one or two, but not very many other than that. But
when I looked at the show last week, or last year that we did, and at the end of the show I said, all of you pledged to cooperate with one another, and you all answered in the affirmative. Has that happened this past year? Cooperation.
I think that we can all point to some instances where that has happened and some instances where it's been a disaster. I think the majority of what we vote on comes out unanimously. But on the big stuff, the real priorities that matter to the people of Michigan, we've got a lot of debate. And frankly, with absolute power, they don't include us in a lot of conversations that they have. I will point to one that we did work together on, particularly the speaker and I, on the bullying issue, where we crafted something that made sense, and ultimately every single one of us supported that. But, you know, in the interim, you've got instances where you've got legislators that are calling names like a PR person in town. One of the senators on Randy's side of the aisle called her a hooker, and then the former head of the Michigan Republican Party used the same term to refer to me. That really hurts the civility at the Capitol, and that's a challenge. And I think we need to be the leaders who say, we're not going to stand for this anymore. That kind of stuff is out of bounds.
Have you heard that from them?
No.
Well, you missed it then, because I came out publicly shortly after one of the senators made a comment where he didn't call somebody a hooker, and I'm not trying to defend it, but what he said was, this person doesn't have the same kind of sets of values. They will work with a Republican or a Democrat. I'm a solid conservative. And I came out and said that the use of that language was inappropriate and apologized on behalf of the Senate. If you didn't hear that, I don't know where you were.
Let's talk about working together and the legislative process. And I understand in the minority, you look and you say, I'm serving in the minority. Number one, it's not too much fun. And number two, I wish I had the pen or the gavel, if you will, to make all the decisions. But I would push back on the argument that we have not worked together. We've already mentioned autism. We've mentioned bullying. If you look at Detroit, working together to make sure that Detroit would be still remain the city with the highest income tax in the state, the only city to level a utility tax, to seeking to help Detroit. We had many meetings, all four of us, working on Highland Park. Now, we all ended up with a resolution that was not supported in a bipartisan effort, but we were around the same table for a couple of weeks trying to work on that issue. Now, I understand some dissatisfaction saying it's not enough, but it's also not my job to hand the gavel to the other party. That's the voters of the state of Michigan. The voters of the state of Michigan determine the direction of the state. I have to respect that. I will absolutely work with my colleagues across the aisle, and I think we've done that, keeping with what we said we'd do.
You know, can I just say, Mr. Speaker, when you talk about respecting the will of the voters of the state of Michigan, you know, what we're seeing come out of on the higher education budget with regard to stem cell research, you know, I think that you're actually contravening the voting will of the people of the state of Michigan. We adopted a constitutional amendment to say we are going to permit stem cell research in mm-hmm. Michigan. And what we've seen out of both the Senate and the House budget chairs is retribution. They're trying to further their own myopic personal agendas to stop stem cell research, when that's exactly what the voters said we want to do.
If I could just interject a little bit, there are some core values that you have that I don't. There are some core values that some conservatives have that, you know, we're just not going to compromise. And we won't agree that we should somehow give up what we really believe in to work together. You believe stem cell research, you're pro-abortion, we're pro-life.
I'm not pro-abortion,
well,
I'm
you're
pro-choice.
Okay.
I'm pro-women's rights.
Okay, I can understand how you would disagree with me on that, and I would disagree with you on that too. But what I'm saying is, push apart the sides where the core values are going to be different. There's a lot of stuff for us to work on. And I think in those instances, we've done a pretty good job of reaching across. I know process-wise in the Senate, and I let Senator Whitmer know what we're doing, when we're doing it. We have a pretty good communication about that. I tell her sometimes, we're going to disagree about this. This is going to be an ugly day for you. You might want to, your caucus might want to be on board. They might not. Can you talk about this? Let me know what they think. From that standpoint, I think we work together pretty well. But I don't think you're going to see us compromising our core values to come across the aisle.
Are you asking them to do that?
To compromise his core? I'm just asking them to follow what the voters of the people, when it comes to stem cell, ask for. There was a vote. People said this. Whether your core values believe in that or not, follow what the people ask. I mean, but I want to say that
people ask this, though.
People voted for stem cell research. You are now compromising the university's ability to provide that.
Wow.
And here we are. I want to say something positive, okay? The speaker has been very good at giving us a calendar, letting us know. And there are things that we can do together, and we have worked on stuff. The Island Park issue was an issue that we worked together. We certainly could not come up with a resolution that made sense for us, but we did talk about it at length for some time, and that was good. That's a positive sign. And I do understand there are things that that they can do and will do because they have the support. Many of these things are done because they all completely agree. It goes fast because of that. But that doesn't mean that we don't have some significant differences, whether it's budget related, tax policy related, or even in some cases social related issues that we have seen that we don't care for and we think that the people of the state don't like either. So there's going to be some compromise, very few times, but there's going to be some problems, and we have had some of them.
But you have felt left out, have you not, at points?
I think on some of the stuff, we've not had an opportunity to be involved in it. We might have tried to steer some of the things in a different direction that were pretty big, significant, like tax policy.
Well, for example, how many times have the four of you met privately with the governor in the past year? Can you count them on one hand?
Twice,
maybe? Yes. Twice. You can count them
on one hand. In 1 year. Is that exemplary, gentlemen?
Well, you only had us on your show once a year. I mean, what the heck?
Nice try, Mr.
kind of
Richardville. The question is
us,
still on the table, Mr. Leader. The question is two enough, or is two too many?
Well, I meet with him every week. That's more than enough.
Well, but that's not the point.
What's that tell you?
Well, what does that tell you?
It tells you that we are not being counted as someone who has a voice in the issues that are important to the state of Michigan. When the majority leader and the speaker meet with the governor on a regular basis and we're not there to at least voice our opinions about some of the things that are important, we don't get that opportunity very often. And that's sad, in my opinion.
Mr. Speaker?
We meet and communicate frequently.
Yes,
I mean,
we do.
I can't think of a week, whether we're in session or not in session, that Minority Leader Hammel and I have not communicated.
And maybe not good, but we're doing it.
That's right. And so. I guess I would like to continue with some of his comment that we're going to disagree. And there are times in the House chamber, if you have the opportunity to watch the House chamber, they have been on some social issues or some other passionate issues where that chamber, you could hear a pin drop. Because there's passionate debate happening, but it's been respectful. And a year in, or a little more than a year in, I will look and say that I believe that Rick Hammel is an honorable man. He's wrong in some cases. And I say that with my tongue in my cheek, that we recognize that we're going to disagree on issues. But I hope that we still have great respect for each other. And when it comes to the five of us getting together, yes, we've had those meetings. But really, the work happens within the chambers as they then get to the governor.
But just as an appearance, and you folks all know that appearance in politics is the reality. Two meetings of the quadrant with the governor in 1 year. What does that say to you?
Well, he talked a lot about working across the aisle and working together to move all of Michigan forward. He talked about metrics. He talked about shared sacrifice. I don't think we've seen any of that. You know, the governor, yeah, he's a nice guy, but we haven't seen the tough. We've seen the nerd, but we have not seen the tough. He likes to say that things he doesn't want to take a position on are not on his agenda. Every time they land on his desk, he signs them into law. You know, I don't think we've seen
him. Well, if he agrees with him, why shouldn't
really
we sign him?
He never says he's agreed with him. He said in back channels that he's not really supportive. He's not pushing it. It's not on his agenda. Well, not on my agenda doesn't mean anything in this town anymore, unfortunately, because he signs everything that comes to his desk. We need strong leadership in Michigan. You know, where was he when the bridge vote was happening? I think someone reported that he was knocking doors in Paul Scott's district. You know, something that was the majority leader's own bill that the governor made a priority in his state of the state, and he wasn't even in town when that vote was cast.
Well, let me say something about this governor. He has taken what I consider to be a real bold leadership stance. Last year, when he came out, inherited a $1.8 billion deficit, and we started talking about ways to solve those problems, fix the economy, I don't think he had all the answers, but he wasn't afraid to go into what I consider very difficult areas and stand up publicly and talk about them. You don't need to meet once a week with everybody to find out what's going on. He's done budget meetings, he's done special messages approximately once a month, he sends one out. It's very detailed. Within hours, usually there's a press release or press conference coming back from the other side. Don't say you don't understand what he's doing because you're responding to it within 24 hours. You must know about it.
I didn't say I didn't understand.
And
I said I didn't like it.
He doesn't come to me and ask me, is this something that we should be doing? He says, this is where I'm going to go. And he also was open to the fact that the legislature sends something back to him. Rarely is it what he rolls out the first time. And I think he does listen to some of the things that you all say. Just because we don't have a private meeting doesn't mean there's not interaction.
You buying that, guys?
No, not really. I mean, we had met for a while. We were meeting in advance of a special message. And there would be a special message on workforce development or on education or something. We'd meet very little in advance, and we'd talk a little bit about it. That would be our opportunity. Outside of that, none, to really just vent, to have an hour and a half just to yell at each other, which you need. We need that.
I called that meeting, and so, you yelled at me.
Yeah, I did. So,
did you get anything done as a result of the yelling?
Well, you know, I think he listens, and that's as far as it goes for the most part. So,
Mr. Richardville, earlier this year, you talked about a potential ballot proposal in August on transportation. Are you still headed there with two or three proposals? Bring us up to date.
Well, I think we need to have that discussion. I think it's an important discussion.
Are you discussing that amongst the four of you?
Yeah, we've started those discussions. The governor has been kind of on the road for a few weeks, and the legislature had a break from being in Lansing. So to get together and talk about that hasn't been real easy, but we will probably, I know on Tuesday it will be on the agenda. It has to be done by, I think, June 1st if we want to have an opportunity to put it on the ballot. I just think that it's smart to consider all options. The governor, again, put something on the table, and I don't agree with fee increases and some of the gas tax changes and some other things that he put up there. I do agree, and I think we all agree, that infrastructure, transportation is maybe the biggest problem we've got that we haven't had a solution found in over a decade.
Mr. Speaker, would you favor putting something on the ballot in August to address this issue?
Oh, we'd have to talk through a whole lot of details. I believe before we talk about additional resources, we need to talk about accountability, efficiency, and dedication of dollars. And this is, transportation is an area that the minority leader and I have had great conversation about, that because this is a solution that needs to come in a bipartisan way.
I didn't hear you say yes to his idea.
I didn't say yes to his idea because we need to discuss it. And so I need to know those details. But again, I think it's premature to look for additional resources before we've made sure that we're doing everything we can with the resources, and more importantly, making sure that the dollars that people pay at the pump actually go, where possible, to roads and infrastructure.
Would you guys sign off on a ballot proposal for August? Mr. Hammel?
What I like that the Senate Majority Leader said is that he's interested in putting something on a ballot he doesn't necessarily believe in. So we may offer a couple options for you that you may not believe in, but allow the people to vote on it. So
I
hope
you're
open for that. I don't know. We're working on a few things.
Well, do you like the sales tax idea, getting rid of the gas tax and going to the sales tax?
We'd have to talk. I think the Speaker and I will probably sit down and talk after it gets through the Senate. If it does get through the Senate, we'll talk. We'll see.
I think this is a prime example of some of the dysfunction in Lansing between the legislature and the governor. Everyone agrees that we need to do something for the infrastructure of Michigan. But kicking it to the voters to ask for the solution, I think is, you know, I want to be a part of that discussion. I have the same goal, but I just think it is another example of some of the dysfunction in Lansing, because we should be able to do some things as elected officials, which we were hired to do, to make a lot of these.
You don't think he has the nerve to put that up for a straight up or down vote?
You know, I didn't say that, Tim, but I think
I'm just asking.
No, I think that when they control every branch of government,
why
and
not
can't
just do it?
All get on one page, it just shows some of the dysfunction that we have.
Maybe it's hard for you all, because I know you haven't served in the majority, but when you're in the majority and you're talking about something on the ballot, you need to have more than a simple majority. We can't assume that. This would be something that would have to be bipartisan, that we talk on both sides of the aisle and say, there are a lot of different components to paying for transportation, to paying for infrastructure. So far, they have failed. I would say that the federal government, the amount of money we send to the federal government, and the lack of a decent return has been our biggest problem over the last 50 years. But as a state, we do have issues that we can address too. And putting it on a ballot is one possibility. But it would have to be bipartisan work, because we don't control all two-thirds of the House and two-thirds of the Senate. So that's the reason why we would have to work together.
I would push back on dysfunction. As you look back a year ago, all the predictions were that we would never get the budget done on time. We'd never get through that tax reform. I see you smiling because you know you were one of those who were saying it could never be done.
I can't remember.
We are facing problems head on and finding solutions. So we are getting the job done, providing results. We can certainly disagree on the path. I do believe that we want to end up in the same place.
And the rest of the country is starting to look at Michigan as a leader. You look at Fitch, the organization that looks at bond ratings. They took Michigan and said, that's not just a stable environment, that's a favorable environment now after the things that they did last year. You look at Bloomberg, they said Michigan is prepared, number two in the country, to come out of the recession. You got other states and other organizations outside of Michigan saying, hey, you should keep your eye on these guys. They're actually doing a pretty good job. I wouldn't call that dysfunction.
Are the governor's policies working to turn the economy around?
I think the economy's turned around because of the automotive industry.
Has it nothing to do with the governor?
I don't think so. I think that the changes that have happened and the revenue being driven, the additional money from the state of Michigan is being driven because of the automotive industry and the changes in many of the policies that were put in place before this administration took office.
I've had debates for the past 8 years or 8 years before this that blamed other people. The credit versus blame game is not productive. The bottom line is to make Michigan a better place to find a job. We have to make Michigan a better place to create a job. That is happening. We're seeing the results. 110,000 private sector jobs created. Unemployment falling. It's no time to let up. Personal income is on the rise. We're seeing good things, but we need to continue that work.
Quickly.
Rick has a good point, and I was called by the national conference on state legislators, whatever, asking about Michigan. The automotive industry is turning around because of the employees and the leadership of those organizations.
And but the Obama small, administration.
Well, it's just a bank. But the, the small businesses are what we have helped to turn around.
Gentlemen and lady, thank you very much. Always a pleasure to have you folks on the show. Good luck as we go forward towards the deadline of June 1. And we'll save this tape, okay?
Who said right. deadline June 1?
He did. I heard him. I heard it with my own ears.
I said target. I didn't say deadline.
I got to get out of here. We'll see you next week on Off the Record.
Production of Off the Record is made possible in part by a grant from Truscott Rossman, Michigan's only bipartisan strategic communications firm, serving statewide, national, and international clients from their offices in Lansing, Detroit, and Grand Rapids. TruscottRossman.com. By the Michigan Food and Beverage Association, in conjunction with the Michigan Business and Professional Association, working together for its members. Membership information on the web at mishbusiness.org. And by Hager Fox Heating and Air Conditioning Company, providing comfort to mid-Michigan homes and businesses since 1941. Hager Fox and Bryant, for whatever it takes, on the web at hagerfox.com. MLive Media Group, providing real-time Michigan news, sports, business, and entertainment at mlive.com. Tim Skubick blogs about Michigan politics daily at mlive.com. Off the Record can be seen online anytime at video.wkar.org. Episodes on DVD are also available for purchase.
Michigan Public TV stations have contributed to the production costs of Off the Record with Tim Skubick.